Welcome to Uncommon Knowledge. I'm Peter Robinson. The program that you're about to watch was filmed in the Caribbean aboard the New Amsterdam during the National Review post-election cruise. That is just a few days after the election of November 2012. Uncommon Knowledge, a production of the Hoover Institution, today at sea with National Review.
News cycles, tweets, and blogs. Today on Uncommon Knowledge, at sea on the National Review post-election cruise, two men who have devoted their lives not to tweets, but to books. On Uncommon Knowledge, Norman Podhoretz, Bernard Lewis, and wisdom. Uncommon Knowledge, now. Welcome to Uncommon Knowledge. I'm Peter Robinson. Today we're shooting at sea on the National Review post-election cruise. A master of more than half a dozen languages, the first Western scholar ever permitted into the archives of the Ottoman Empire, and by universal consent, the most influential historian of Islam and of the Middle East in the last half century, Bernard Lewis is professor emeritus of Near Eastern Studies at Princeton. Dr. Lewis's most recent book, written with Bunsey Ellis Churchill, Notes on a Century, Reflections of a Middle East Historian. Recognized from youth as a brilliant writer and critic, Norman Podhoretz studied at Columbia with Lionel Trilling and at Cambridge with F.R. Leavis. For 3.5 decades, he served as editor-in-chief of Commentary magazine, making a public and notorious intellectual journey from left to right. In 2004, Norman Podhoretz received the Presidential Medal of Freedom. Norman Podhoretz's most recent book of many, Why Are Jews Liberal? Bernard Lewis and Norman Podhoretz, welcome to Uncommon Knowledge.
Thank you.
We want to talk about the Middle East and how to understand the Arab world. Tell us about the Turkish election of 1950, which delighted you and the aftermath of which appalled you.
I was in Turkey at the time. I was spending a year in the Middle East, most of the time in Turkey. And I was therefore able to watch the whole process. It was the first time in Middle Eastern history that the government in power held a genuinely free and fair election, lost that election, and then handed over power to the victorious opposition. This was a milestone event in the history of the Middle East, and it was fascinating to watch.
And then what happened?
Unfortunately, things began to go wrong. The leader of the new party that came in soon made it clear that he was determined not to leave by the same route by which he came, and that having come into power, he intended to stay in power. And he began to change things in one way and another to ensure the continuance of his regime. I remember vividly one day I was sitting in Ankara in the faculty lounge at the university with some Turkish colleagues, and we were talking of this and that. And we got onto the question of the founders of political movements. And one of them said, well, obviously, the father of fascism was Mussolini. Another one said, yes. And the father of Nazism was Hitler. And the third one said, yes. And in Turkey, the father of democracy was Adnan Menderes. And the others looked at him in bewilderment and said, Adnan Menderes, the father of democracy? He said, yes, well, he screwed the mother of democracy. I vividly remember that, as you can imagine.
Bernard, quoting you in an interview you gave to the Jerusalem Post last year, quote, democracy is a political concept that has no history, no record whatever in the Arab Islamic world. The Arab Islamic world comes into being around, what, 700 or so. There's one little shot at democracy in 1950 and it doesn't work. But why should this be that while Europe is developing democracy, in the Arab world it simply does not take root?
Well, we have to understand what we mean when we use the word democracy. We tend to use the word to mean our kind of democracy.
Right.
Regular elections, free elections, fair elections, and if the government is defeated, it removes itself from power, hands over to the opposition. I think it's unreasonable that we should expect the rest of the world to accept our methods and our traditions. Our methods grew out of our history. They have a different history. And they have also a tradition of limited, responsible government, but it worked in a different way. I mean, the magic word in the Muslim Middle East is consultation. There were, in the pre-modern Middle East, there were many institutions in which, and this is the really important point, institutions in which power arose not from above, but from within. There were the craft guilds. There were various professional associations. There were commercial corporations of various kinds, and so on and so forth.
These would be in the urban cities. These would be Cairo, Damascus,
Istanbul, Beirut, and so on. In all these places, you had these organizations where, as I said, power came from within the group and not from outside. There's a fascinating letter written by the French ambassador in Istanbul a few years before the French Revolution. He had been instructed to carry on with certain negotiations with the Ottoman government, and they were proceeding very slowly. And he received a rather sharp reprimand from Paris, saying, you know, why the hell don't you get on with this? Why are you taking so long? And the ambassador wrote a memorable reply, which I have often quoted. He said, here, meaning here in the Ottoman Empire, he said, here it is not like in France, where the king is sole master and does as he pleases. He said, here the Sultan has to consult. He has to consult with all sorts of people. And this was true. The Sultan had to consult with all sorts of different institutions where power or authority arose from within the group. And that was certainly the case before modernization. The tragedy is that all that was destroyed by modernization. It was the process of modernization which made the Middle East, in that respect, a much worse place. Because what modernization did was to vastly increase the power of the state, the power of supervision and control, and vastly reduce the authority of the various local institutions.
Norman, President Barack Obama, in an address in Cairo on June 4th, 2009, this is shortly after he was inaugurated the first time, quote, "I've come here to Cairo to seek a new beginning with the United States and Muslims around the world." He went on to talk about common interests, mutual respect. How did that work out?
Well, it not only did not work out in the terms in which he expressed it, but it worked out very much the opposite. Mm-hmm. I mean, that speech is notorious because it's taken by many people, including me, to be the beginning of the so-called apology tour, in which the new President Obama went around explaining that the United States had much to answer for, misdeeds that he felt he had to expiate. And that's what he meant by a new beginning. We're going to understand that we, as say the United States, are at fault, at least as much as our former adversaries, and that we come together in mutual respect. My own view of that speech, among the many other things I found wrong and, in fact, contemptible about it, was that many of the misdeeds that he was abstractly referring to were imaginary. I mean, if you wanted to draw up a balance sheet in our relations with the Arab Muslim world, you would have to take into account the fact that the United States, even in recent times, went to war several times in aid of Muslim populations in Serbia and Kosovo, and our interventions in Iraq and Afghanistan had the effect of liberating millions of Muslims from local tyrannies. Of course, the long-range consequences are not so promising as they might have been. And of course, the so-called Arab Spring, which was taken by many people to be a promising beginning of a democratization of that world, has turned out to be much more like an Arab winter. And the fact that there have been free elections in Egypt, for example, there's no great consolation since it had brought to power the Muslim Brotherhood, which in my view is a far worse regime and also adversary of the United States than the Mubarak regime was. And I think that you will find in Syria, when and if Assad falls, a similar group will take over.
Bernard, this interview in the Jerusalem Post last year again, I'm quoting you once again. Bernard Lewis, quote, "I don't think the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt is in any sense benign. I think it is a very dangerous, radical Islamic movement. If they obtain power, the consequences would be disastrous for Egypt." They have obtained power.
Yes.
They control the parliament. They elected a president of the Muslim Brotherhood. Within a few weeks, the new president of the country, a member of the Muslim Brotherhood, had removed from office the highest-ranking military officer, demonstrating his dominance within the country. Now, the theory is that they may be bad now, anti-American, radical, but democracy will shape them up. They'll be forced to build some power plants and make sure the garbage gets removed and see to all the little pacifying duties that democratic governments must see to in order to get reelected. Do you buy it?
No, I don't. As has happened in other places where we impose democracy, the government that was freely elected came into power and then tried to make sure that it would not leave by the same route by which it came.
So what you would expect in Egypt is a replay of Turkey in 1950.
I mean, the definition of democracy is a free election once.
Right, right. Segment two. Let's talk a little bit. We've talked a bit about the Arab world. Let's talk about this country, American exceptionalism. Two quotations. First, Norman Podhoretz, speaking this past autumn at Hillsdale College. Quote, "Once upon a time, hardly anyone dissented from the idea that the United States of America was different from other nations," close quote. President Barack Obama in France in 2009, quote, "I believe in American exceptionalism, just as I suspect that the Brits believe in British exceptionalism and the Greeks believe in Greek exceptionalism," close quote. Norman, how did we go from once upon a time when everybody understood this country was different to, oh well, we're no different from the Brits or the Greeks? What happened?
Well, the corruption of the culture is what happened. Our educational system, starting practically in kindergarten, has inculcated a view of the United States which was very different from the one that people of our generation grew up with. American history is generally seen as a series of oppressions of one group or another. This has led, at the very least, to what we nowadays call a multiculturalist perspective, which all cultures are equal, except for ours. We are exceptional in the sense of being exceptionally bad.
Right.
Now, the point I made in that talk stands, I believe. I mean, even today, I think most people outside of the United States regard us as exceptional in the sense of different. The only debate, and that debate began with the very founding of the country, was whether this exceptionalism was a good thing or a bad thing. There were passionate views on both sides of that issue. As time went on, the exceptionalism of the United States, that is the fact that it was distinctive, different from all other countries on the face of the earth, became more and more manifest. If we had time, I could list some of the symptoms. But hardly anyone until recently would have said the United States is no different from other countries.
Bernard, by upbringing and temperament and deportment, you remain in all kinds of ways an Englishman. Do you buy all this business of American exceptionalism, or do people like Norman and me get carried away?
No, I think there is an American exceptionalism, but I'm not sure that we wouldn't define it in the same way. I first came to this country as a visitor in 1956, and came many times after that, and then finally moved here in 1974. I vividly remember my first impressions as a newcomer, some positive, some negative. The first negative impression that I had was the pattern of discrimination by race, by sex, by religion, by all kinds of things. So the sort of thing which in England would have been unknown and impossible. Hotels that wouldn't accept guests of this or that kind. The positive thing, which again, very different from us, was the acceptance of the newcomer. In England, and this I know personally because I was part of the British service during the war, in England, for any position of trust, you had to have at least two generations of British birth. So that, for example, the career of a Kissinger would have been impossible in England, not because he was Jewish. We had Jews rising to the highest positions, but because he was a naturalized immigrant. On the other hand, the career of a Margaret Thatcher would have been impossible in America. It was a woman who became the leader of her party, led it through an election, won that election, and formed a government.
Do you want to push back a little bit?
Yeah, there's no question that we have
we'll be mud wrestling in just a moment.
There's no question that we have a history of discrimination against various groups, but that history is also marked by efforts, powerful efforts, to overcome those defects. And, you know, the Thomas Jefferson, who owned slaves, once said memorably that I tremble for my country when I reflect that God is just. And you might take that as a prescient or prophetic statement about what was to come. And what was to come was the bloodiest war the United States had ever fought and still has ever fought, the Civil War, which more Americans were killed than in any other war we've been involved in. This is a measure of the extent to which this country has struggled to overcome some of the defects, slavery being the most serious. But you could point to other fields which were areas of discrimination in 1956, which are not only no longer areas of, but just the opposite, positive discrimination.
Right. I mean. American exceptionalism in the world. Again, two quotations. Once again, President Obama speaking in 2009 in Cairo. Quote, "We meet at a time of great tension between the United States and Muslims. Tension has been fed by colonialism that denied rights and opportunities to many Muslims and a Cold War in which Muslim-majority countries were too often treated as proxies." Close quote. Quotation number two. Bernard Lewis, in the interview in the Jerusalem Post in 2011, quote, "People who talk about American imperialism in the Middle East either know nothing about America or know nothing about the Middle East."
Or both.
Or both. Bernard, so the President of the United States, at some basic level, did not know what he was talking about in Cairo.
Yeah, that's not unprecedented.
What is it that he doesn't understand about the United States and or the Middle East to suggest that we've been imperialists there, or at a minimum, overbearing there?
It depends what you mean by imperialism. I think that one might not unreasonably use the term imperialist to describe some of the processes by which the original small group of states increased to the present number. But as applied to American policy...
The Western migration, right, in this.
But
in
as applied
States.
To American policy in the Middle East, it is absurdly inappropriate. I mean, to take the two classical examples of imperialism, when the Romans went to Britain 2,000 years ago, or when the British went to India 300 years ago, an exit strategy did not figure prominently among their concerns.
So the United States, the American role in the Middle East... Let's say from the end of the Second World War, when FDR has his famous meeting on shipboard with the King of Saudi Arabia, right through the invasion of Iraq, was on balance benign.
Yes.
You'd argue that?
I would agree. That was certainly.
Well,
it was sometimes mistaken, but it was never malevolent.
It's fascinating that you bring up that meeting with the.
King Saud.
When you look back, it's astonishing to realize that Roosevelt was more worried about British imperialism than about Soviet imperialism.
Yes,
And this is a measure of the American attitude toward imperialism. I mean, here was a WASP aristocrat, and you would expect to be Anglophile and passionate about defending England. And he thought the great danger that we faced in the post-war period was British imperialism. I mean, it's
and Eisenhower scotched the Suez.
Well, same reason.
Operation.
The same reason. So there was an anti.
On behalf of Egypt,
right,
and
exactly,
against Israel, France, and
exactly.
Britain.
Exactly, and there's an anti-imperialist streak in American political culture that is much deeper than anything that you could legitimately describe as imperialism. I mean, we invaded Iraq to topple Saddam Hussein. Now, if we had been engaged in an imperialist adventure at that point, we would have settled in permanently,
right, exactly,
run the country, exploited it. As many opponents of the invasion said, we were there for the oil. Well, not only were we not there for the oil, we helped them restore their production of oil. And you could almost say that the United States, in its adventures abroad, was more exploited than exploiter, from an economic point of view, certainly.
Segment three, what the Arabs want. Again, I'm quoting you. It's delightful to quote you to yourself, to have you right here for explication. Henry Kissinger has famously once remarked that when he has lunch with Bernard Lewis, he does something which is very unusual. He listens. All right, Bernard Lewis, quote, I can imagine a situation in which the Muslim Brotherhood and other organizations of the same kind obtain control of much of the Arab world. And if that happens, they would gradually sink back into medieval squalor, close quote. Does the Muslim Brotherhood, do the radicals in the world of Islam genuinely wish to reestablish some kind of caliphate?
Well, I don't know whether I would use the word caliphate, but they certainly wish to establish an Islamic political order, political and social order, yes.
That would occupy what we think of as the territory, roughly, broadly speaking, of the former Ottoman, Northern Africa up through to
Yes.
That is seriously on the agenda.
Oh, yes, I'm sure it is.
That seems clear to you as well?
Absolutely clear. I mean, they say it all the time.
Exactly.
And you know, take them seriously.
Well, I've become an octogenarian, and if I've acquired any wisdom at all, it consists in taking at face value the threats of one's enemies. There's a kind of pathology at work in the world that refuses to believe. Somebody says, I want to kill you. You say, wait, can't possibly mean that.
Beginning with Mein Kampf, he didn't really mean it.
Right, and we can do business with Herr Hitler, as I forget who said it, Chamberlain, as a matter of fact, said. So you have a country like Iran, which of course is Muslim, which repeatedly declares its intention to wipe Israel off the map. And many people still refuse to take that. They say it's rhetoric. I remember the late Hannah Arendt described the rhetoric of Eichmann, who said he would go to his grave happy at the thought of having massacred millions of Jews. And she said, this was sheer rhodomontade, a nice fancy word that means exaggerated rhetoric. Red meat for the consumption of the base. Well, he meant it, and Hitler meant it, and Ahmadinejad means it, and I think the Muslim Brotherhood means it, and not just in relation to Israel.
You agree with all of that, Bernard? But why is it, if the Muslim Brotherhood is trying to reestablish what they understand as the greatness of Islam, why aren't they listening to you and thinking of looking within their own political tradition to reestablish some kind of consultative, balanced, prudent, wise political order of the kind that at its best did characterize the Islamic world? Instead, they're crazy, radical hotheads.
Yeah.
Is that fair? They don't seem to understand their own history and tradition. Is that so?
Unfortunately, as I said before, the process of modernization.
Well, when you say modernization, what do you mean? You mean post the collapse of the Ottoman Empire after the end of the First World War?
I mean the introduction of modern science, technology, business, etc. all the features of modern life, including most especially communication.
So when you say that they will sink back to, if they win, they'll sink back to medieval squalor, it's because they will try to, they actually consider these developments antithetical to their own civilization, to their own religion?
Well, they would use those developments in order to restore, what they imagined to be the golden age of Islam.
Well, let me quote Bernard Lewis at himself. Bernard once pointed out in a passage that I have quoted at least six times in print that the modern political Islamic radicalism has as much owes as much to both communism and Nazism as it does to the traditions of Islam. I mean, and he points out that the Germans came into the Middle East during World War II, and its political program and organization had a lot to do, for example, with the founding of the Ba'ath parties. Yeah. And when the war was over, the communists moved in, and the political forces, the Islamic political forces, also learned a lot of lessons from the communists and how to operate politically. So you had these two major totalitarian forces of the 20th century basically invading the 7th century culture of the Islamic world, and it led to what I like to call Islamofascism.
There's an important principle which I think needs to be remembered. There's an Arabic saying, the enemy of my enemy is my friend. Since the dominant civilization in the Western world was our Western democratic system, we were seen as the wicked imperialists who were dominating the Middle East. And therefore, our enemies were their friends. So that during the Nazi period, they were pro-Nazi, and after that, they were pro-Soviet.
Right. Bernard, you knew, this is just occurring to me, you knew, or at least you met, Gaddafi, and you knew quite well King Hussein of Jordan.
Yes, I knew both of them.
What did those two men want? When, if you could say, if you may have the Arab world as you wish to arrange it, what would it have looked like if Gaddafi had had his way? What would it have looked like if Hussein had had his way?
I can't say.
You don't know.
Not pretty?
No. In either case?
In either case.
Yeah. I always took King Hussein as someone who was trying to move the Arab world into the
Western
sphere.
Well, you know, King Hussein has a reputation for benevolence that he does not deserve. And I'll give you one example of what King Hussein, the wonderful King Hussein, did. When King Hussein ruled what is called the West Bank. The mandatory Palestine. He used an ancient Jewish graveyard for set up latrines in this ancient Jewish graveyard, using the headstones for the foundation. That's one of many not very attractive
not
things.
Not such a nice guy after all.
He was not such a nice guy. He was British educated. He had a good accent. He was charming. Didn't he have an American wife?
He did?
Yeah, well, so...
Queen Noor,
So everybody loved it.
Segment 4, Iran. Norman
Iran.
Norman Podhoretz in an interview in, I will now mispronounce this, how is it pronounced?
Arutz Sheva.
Arutz Sheva, thank you. This past spring, quoting you,
I don't remember.
If Iran gets the bomb, it is hard, if not impossible, to see how a nuclear exchange between Iran and Israel could be avoided, close quote. Now, you know the answer to that, Norman. The Soviet Union had the bomb, and we had the bomb, and we sat facing each other for 4.5 decades and did not engage in a nuclear exchange.
Yeah. Well, I'll give you Bernard Lewis's answer to that question, and then I'll give you my own. Bernard Lewis points out that deterrence worked with the Soviets and the Chinese because the Soviets were not suicidal, and they knew that if they launched a first strike, there would be a second strike that would annihilate them.
Mutual assured destruction.
And it worked.
And mutual assured destruction can't work in relation to Iran because these are people who, you might say, are in love with easeful death.
Exactly. For them, it's not a deterrent, it's an inducement.
So that, truly. truly.
Yeah, yeah. Well, those 72 versions beckon. I will give you my answer to that. That's right. Bernard's answer to the question. My answer to the question is to imagine a scenario which most people are horrified. I mean, I've tried this at speeches all the time, and people shy away from it. Imagine that Iran gets the bomb, okay? And the Israelis are sitting there and asking themselves, do we wait for them to hit us and then retaliate out of the rubble, or do we preempt and hit them first? The Iranians are asking themselves the same question. Do we wait for the Israelis to hit us, or do we hit them first? We've never had a hair trigger situation like that since the invention of nuclear weapons. And if you just imagine the rulers of Israel, the rulers of Iran, asking themselves that question, somebody is going to beat the other to the punch. I can't see that unstable situation lasting for very long. Maybe even as long as a few weeks or months.
Mm. And you would agree, but Bernie, here's what I find so striking. You will hear it said among people who are not deep students of the situation, that the notion of a glorious death is an inducement to the radicals in the Muslim world, yes. Not a deterrent. And here I sit across from a man who has devoted his life to the study of Islam, who is universally regarded as the greatest living historian of the world of Islam, and he says, yes, as a matter of fact, that's exactly right. It is an inducement. Deterrence would not work. You confirm that for me.
I would do, yes, with those who are committed believers in the old sense.
So help me to distinguish between, and you yourself, wait, I have the quotation here, your famous 1990 essay in The Atlantic. Yes, here it is. Your famous 1990 essay in The Atlantic magazine.
So let me interject and say, that was the second piece that Bernard wrote about the return of Islam. The first one appeared in Commentary in 1976 and was much better than the one in The Atlantic.
There are no new ideas in the world, just essays that have first appeared in Commentary that haven't been adequately absorbed yet. All right.
Thou hast said it.
All right. Bernard Lewis, writing in 1990 in The Atlantic, Islam has brought comfort and peace of mind to countless millions of men and women. It inspired a great civilization, but Islam has also known periods when it inspired in some of its followers a mood of hatred and violence. It is our misfortune that part of the Muslim world is now going through such a period and that much of that hatred is directed against us. Close quote. And the most important questions of the day lie right in that one paragraph. Why are they going through such a period of hatred now? And why do they direct their hatred against us?
In the Muslim perception, there is an endless struggle going on between the true believers and the misbelievers. And this struggle will go on until the final stage when the true believers will triumph and the misbelievers will be conquered and either converted or subjugated. Now, there is a widespread belief among Muslims at the present time that that time is now present or immediately approaching.
We live in the end times.
Yes, we live at the end of time. And a lot of things happening in the world do give some support to that. And we live at the end of time. This is the final stage when we will all get to our final destinations. And that means that mutual assured destruction, as I said before, is not a deterrent, it's an inducement.
Well, so George W. Bush was wrong. Islam is not a religion of peace. You see, what I'm trying to do is, it's not a fringe element. The antipathy toward the West stems from deep within the religion and the tradition itself.
It's a mistranslation. You know, the Muslim greeting is Salaamu Alaikum, which is usually translated, peace be with you. But Salaam doesn't mean peace, it means salvation.
And Islam, I believe, means submission. I, by the way, contrary to what an awful lot of people now feel, believe that George W. Bush was a great president.
You spoil for a fight every day,
I
don't
do
you?
It. Well, one of the things wrong with him that compromised his greatness was his fear of seeming to be at war with the whole Muslim world. When he wanted to be at war only with the radical Islamists or again, what I insist on calling Islamofascism.
Right.
And he bent over backwards to dispel any possible impression that the enemy was Islam, which is why he continually praised Islam as a religion of peace and various other characterizations. And there was a short period when he began or tried to name the enemy as Islamist radicalism, and the roof fell in on him, and he retreated from that thereafter. So we were in the position, and still are, by the way, fighting a war. We've had on two fronts, really three, one Iraq, the other Afghanistan, and the Cold War with Iran, against an enemy which has remained nameless.
Name it.
Islamofascism. And I'll tell you what I mean by Islamofascism, partly what I learned from Bernard about the influence of both Nazism and communism on the politics of the Islamist groups of the 20th century. But I think that this is an enemy with a two-headed enemy. One is religious and one is political, secular. The religious element is Islamist, and the expectations that Bernard described that the religious Muslims hold. And the other was the secular face, which could be summarized or epitomized by Saddam Hussein. And when we went to war after 9/11, we went to war first against one of these heads, that is the religious one in Afghanistan, and then the what I would call the secular head, mm-hmm. the fascist part. I think that, and when I say I think that George W. Bush was a great president, I think he properly understood the nature of the threat that had been posed against us even before 9/11, but that we finally recognized, awoke to after 9/11, and designed a strategy to contend with it, much as Harry Truman did in 1948 in the face of the threat of Soviet totalitarianism. And we are still fighting this war, only nobody wants to recognize it. I mean, it was hardly mentioned in the presidential campaign we've just concluded.
Bernard, Indonesia is Muslim. Indonesia does not pose any great threat to us. As best I can tell, they don't even have it. Economic development, control their own sea lanes. It's not even the 100th on their list of to-do items, attack the great state in the United States. It just isn't part of the culture, either religious or political culture, as best I can tell. What is it that is distinctive about Arab is Muslim, Islam? Why should it be that the Arab Islam in particular should have it out for us?
Because the Arabs were for a long time the founders and leaders of Islam, the runners of the Arab state, and they still retain this perception of history as a struggle, an ongoing struggle between the true believers and the misbelievers and the unbelievers, whatever you choose to call them, which must go on until it ends in the final victory of the true believers.
So,
I mean, the Indonesians didn't have that experience. Another thing about the Indonesians that struck me when I was there is the hostility to Arabs. And I found out the reason why. I spent a little while in Indonesia some time ago. Indonesia is a solidly Muslim country.
Yes.
But it was never conquered by the Arabs. It was converted to Islam. Arabs used to go there from time to time with an air of lordly superiority, you know. We come from the founders of the faith, and we will teach you the true way. And the Indonesians were infuriated by this.
It was also true of the Persians. That is the right.
Yeah.
I mean,
the Indonesia was particularly striking. I remember once I was at a dinner in Indonesia, and someone was sitting next to me who was translating for me because all of the speakers were of course in Indonesian.
The one language you don't speak.
No, not at all. There are many that I don't speak. I don't know any Indonesian. And anyway. The man was speaking, and at one point he made a remark and brought a tremendous thunder of applause, and my translator didn't say anything. So I said, well, what did he say? And he said, well, it doesn't matter. And I had to find out from someone else who told me afterwards what he said. He said, the fact that we are Muslim doesn't mean to say that we have to behave like Arabs. And he said, God, in order to show the absolute perfection of his mission, chose the worst people in the worst place on earth to reveal it.
Bernard, one more quotation from you. We're drawing to a close here. This is from your latest book, Notes on a Century. Quote, the Arabs have gone through some bad times, but there are elements in their society which can be nurtured to develop into some limited consensual government in their own cultural tradition. Close quote. What can we do, if anything, what can we do to nurture those elements?
We can refrain from supporting tyrants.
Refrain from supporting tyrants.
Yeah, we have a record, unfortunately, in modern times of judging people entirely by one factor. Are they with us or against us?
So you accept part of Obama's critique of the Cold War, that we propped up Mubarak, we propped up the regime, the kingdom of
Saudi. Well, Mubarak wasn't so bad.
Ah, all right.
Well, but I don't mean to. You always have to ask the question, compared to what?
Exactly.
I mean, I remember that the Shah of Iran, who was a modernizer, was eager to grant equal rights to women, and who was hated by the Muslims for what we would consider his virtues, not
yes.
his vices.
Right.
And we sat by and allowed Khomeini to overthrow him, and everybody said,
yes.
Wonderful, wonderful. Well, the Khomeini regime turned out to be far worse for the people living under it, and certainly for our interests, than the Shah.
Well, worst of all for the Iranians.
And worst of all for the Iranians. And so you always have to ask what the alternatives are. And
exactly.
There are those who keep telling us that there are these hidden liberals in the Arab world that we should support. I've been hearing that for, 20 years now.
At least.
And where are they hiding, one asks. I'm sure
in
there
California.
Are. In California. California. I'm sure there are such people there, but they are not very numerous, not very vocal. And we're now faced with that dilemma in Syria. I mean, we're told to give arms to the opposition. Now, we know that the opposition has been infiltrated by al-Qaeda. Nobody knows who the good guys are, if any, in that opposition. And
Norman, so you just said George W. I was almost up to my last question. I take it back. This is my penultimate question, and then we'll get to the last question. Penultimate question. You just said George W. Bush was a great president. And after 4,000 American deaths in Iraq, 100,000 Iraqi deaths, the Kagans, Frederick Kagan and Kimberly Kagan, just wrote a piece in the Weekly Standard saying, it's all slipping away from us in Iraq.
Well, they're blaming Obama for that.
Blaming Obama,
Bush.
Excuse me. No, but after all we've done, the Iraqis are not yet in charge of a decent country of their own in Iraq.
Right. Mm.
In Afghanistan, after all we've done, the government in Kabul spends as much time thumbing its nose at us as attempting to establish a decent government in Kabul itself, let alone in the rest of the country.
Right.
And so the implicit argument here is for American engagement. We have to, at a minimum, remain alert to this threat. We must deal with it. We must pay the cost. And I say to you, Norman, we're tired of it.
Believe
You're
it
asking
or,
too much.
Yeah, believe
You're,
it or not,
leave
I
Leave them an, to themselves.
Yeah, believe it or not, I have an answer to that question.
I'm not remotely surprised.
It's highly ironic. What has turned out to be the great defect in the strategy that led to the invasion of Iraq and Afghanistan, and then the invasion of Iraq, is that we were not imperialistic enough. If we had been prepared to assume the responsibility that an imperial power like Britain in its heyday would have done, which was to actually nurture creation of a new kind of government in both those countries.
Run the country unambiguously and train people in certain techniques. Yeah,
up to a certain point. But you have to be willing. That's a responsibility that we were not willing to take upon ourselves, which may turn out to mean that the sacrifice was wasted. But I don't think it was destined to be wasted. I mean, I should have recognized, Bush should have recognized, that the American people don't have it in them or don't have the willingness to do what an imperial power would necessarily have to do in those circumstances, in the aftermath of those wars.
Bernard, your answer to the American who says at this stage, I was with you a decade ago, but I've had enough. Let's do the minimum we must to contain the Islamic threat, to keep our country safe within its own borders, and the hell with them aside from that. Leave the Arabs to the Arabs. What do you say to that?
Well, I agree that we should use a minimum presence in the Middle East. There's no good reason for staying, apart from the obvious one of preventing it from falling into the hands of really dangerous hostile forces. But
So we should substantially leave them to themselves.
The Middle East no longer matters all that much.
Explain.
Because of fracking? Because of oil shale.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
Because the Middle East has nothing apart from oil and gas, and sooner or later that will be either superseded or exhausted. They have nothing else to offer, and the Middle East will sink into insignificance, and that's already beginning.
You're going to let that one stand?
No. I mean, I would that it were so, but I have to remind. We have to remind ourselves that we were not secure in our own borders, as 9/11 proved. I mean, neither the communists nor the Nazis ever hit us where we live, ever succeeded. Not Hitler, not Stalin ever hit our home territory. These people did. And they will continue to do it again. Wherever they have a chance. Now, the Bush strategy, which I still basically believe in, said, well, they've been coming to us, so we better go to them and prevent that area from becoming a seedbed, a nurturing ground, a swamp in which these monsters are bred. And I still think that's true. The problem is that in order for that policy to succeed, again, we would have had to assume the responsibility of being there. And I would like to agree with Bernard that we can basically get away with minimal involvement, I fear that, what happened in Benghazi is only a small taste of what we would face here at home, not just American.
Last question. Now we are really too, I promise, this is the last question. Throughout the Cold War, there was a base of expert knowledge, and throughout most of the Cold War, a high degree of public debate on the issues. And when I talk about the base of expert knowledge, what I mean is that we have, right from the get-go, George Kennan's long telegram, which lays out what became the containment policy, is, as I recall, 1946. It's right from the get-go. Because there were scholars who had been studying the Soviet Union. We had scholars of Russian history. There were a lot of people who understood what was going on. They had to reflect on it. But from the get-go, there was an understanding in this country of the nature of the threat. And then throughout the Cold War, in every presidential campaign, right up until the fall of the Soviet Union, Cold War policy was a central aspect of the debate. That was then. Now we come to this struggle against radical Islamofascism. It has been more than a decade since they hit the Twin Towers, and I would argue that there has not been a long telegram. We have the two of you, there are a few others, but there has been no consensus. We have no consensus in the State Department, in the foreign policy apparatus, point one. Point two, we just went through a presidential campaign in which the Republican candidate, particularly in the third debate, the foreign policy debate, was at pains to agree with the stand of the president.
Yeah.
All right. We now move to a new generation of Republicans. Bobby Jindal of Louisiana, Paul Ryan of Wisconsin, Senators Marco Rubio of Florida, Ted Cruz of Texas. Where are they to get their foreign policy counsel? Where is the thinking taking place? Where is the debate, the policy debate, taking place? Norman?
Well, the policy debate has gone dead. I mean, modesty forbids my referring to certain books and articles.
Hereby grant you the right to tell the truth.
Well, all right. I wrote a book called World War IV, The Long Struggle Against Islamofascism. World War IV because I regard, along with Elliot Cohn and others, the Cold War as World War III.
Right.
Now, again, just to back up a bit if we have time, there's an illusion now that there was a perfect consensus during the Cold War on the nature of the enemy and what we had to do about it. That's nonsense, and some of us have the scars to prove it. There was always a powerful opposition to the policy of resisting Soviet expansionism. It goes on to this very day. I mean, we have books coming out by the week saying the whole thing was an illusion, the Soviets were
under
threat.
Reagan prolonged the Cold War.
Yeah, Reagan, right. And Reagan didn't win the Cold War, Gorbachev, and et cetera. That group in the political culture that opposed our resistance to Soviet imperialism, as I would call it, now sits in the White House. And it is pursuing a policy within the culture that grows directly out of the anti-communist political culture of the Cold War, that I think is the tragedy. There is no debate, partly because those who want to fight the war have not been able to name it, or those of us who've named it have been ignored, also because the dominant faction now in the culture, unlike what happened in 1947-48, is opposed to doing anything, you know, doesn't think there is a war, thinks the whole thing is a figment of neoconservative imagination.
Bernard?
I would agree with that, and I would add one detail. I think one of the problems is that we are not sufficiently well informed about what's going on in that part of the world. It's not too difficult to follow what's happening. Thanks to the wonders of modern communication, telephone, radio, television, and all the rest of it. But the problem is that we have to rely on translators. And the translators are almost invariably from the Middle East. And I won't say that they want to deceive, but they don't want to displease. And I had occasion to compare the translations of Arabic broadcasts made for the British government with the translations of the same broadcasts made for the American government by the Arab translators employed by the British government and the Arab translators employed by the American government. And there were significant differences in them. In the ones prepared for the British government, anything anti-American was emphasized. Anything anti-British was either deleted or toned down. In the ones prepared for the American government, it was the exact opposite. It's becoming increasingly difficult, and this is really dangerous, even for policymakers to know what is being said, let alone what is being done in the Middle East. And I think it is very important to have more accurate, more intimate coverage of the public discourse in the Middle East. It would be very important.
There is a place where you can get that, and it's organization called MEMRI, Middle East Media Research Institute.
Right, online.
Which regularly publishes translations, also of sermons on video, and from the Arabic and Islamic press. And I believe those translations are accurate.
Didn't receive much attention in the official.
Well, that, alas.
All right. That wasn't my last question. Here's my last question. So what are you optimistic about?
Well, you know, I am incorrigibly optimistic about the United States of America. I don't think that we are an empire in decline, though no empire lasts forever, but we're not an empire.
Right.
So both premises are false. We're not an empire, and we're not in decline. I think despite the blow that my faith in the American public has taken from this last election.
It was only 100,000 votes here or there.
Right, so it's that close. But I continue to believe that that there is health and vitality and good sense in this nation, especially if we eliminate the the left and right coasts, where I often say where I live is Plague Central, which is in Manhattan, of course. And but so I continue to believe in American exceptionalism. I continue to believe that in the end, I think Churchill said, after we do all the wrong things, we finally do the right thing.
Mm-hmm. Right.
I take consolation from the fact that during the Cold War, some of the great figures, thinkers, were not only pessimistic, but believed we were doomed. Whitaker Chambers said when he left the Communist Party, I've left the winning side, I've joined the losing side. James Burnham, a very brilliant geopolitical thinker, wrote a book called Suicide of the West, which was very plausible. They turned out to be wrong, thank God. And I think that in the end, this country will, do the right thing and will prevail, not in the sense of a triumphant, conquest of the world, but prevail in continuing to be what it has been, in my judgment, throughout its history, and certainly since 1940, a benevolent force in the world and in international affairs, helping to defeat the two great totalitarian challenges, one from the left and one from the right, and will eventually defeat the third totalitarian challenge, namely Islamofascism, much in the way it finally managed to do for the other two.
Bernard Lewis raised an Englishman, having devoted your life to the study of Islam. Are you optimistic about the United States?
Yes, I am.
For the same reasons?
Yes.
Well, if I may say so, gentlemen, that is a relief. Bernard Lewis, Norman Podhoretz, thanks for joining us.
Thank you. Thank you.
For Uncommon Knowledge, at Sea with National Review, I'm Peter Robinson.